practice it. Let's talk later.
You've been practicing for 2 years. Do you feel that there's been any progress?
Yeah, 2 years ago I knew 3 songs. Now I know 30.
Quantity is not what I'm talking about. You may know 30 songs, but you play them all equally badly. I hate to tell you this, kid, but you sound like a bunch of cats on a hot tin roof.
You don't have to be good to be famous. All we want to do is be famous.
Now, wait a minute. In music, the music comes first. When I was going to college...
Grandpa, not another story.
Well, I've been listening to you. Now, you listen to me. I was just home from the war, putting myself through the University of Chicago, waiting on tables, which is an art, in case you don't know. You don't start at the top. You break in where you can learn the ropes. Perfect your style till you're at the top, like Colosimo's restaurant. The best food, the best service, the best Dixieland jazz. I was crazy about jazz. I kept it quiet. I only played that one song, but I was jazzing with some of the best.
What are you trying to tell me, Grandpa?
I guess I'm saying, keep on going. You may never get famous or play with any real geniuses, but the journey along the way is bound to be interesting.
All right, I'll get back to it.
Go ahead.
Grandpa, what are you doing?
The neighbors are complaining.
If you don't stop, I'm going to call the police.
You don't understand what we're trying to do. Grandpa, we're pushing the envelope.
You're pushing us.
I know. Don't think I don't understand. I had some friends in Chicago in 1920 who were licking the gum off envelopes, too.
Grandpa, not now.
I was at the University of Chicago studying archaeology, huh? And I was waiting tables at night at Colosimo's restaurant. Torrio and Capone took over Colosimo's operation, and the bootleg wars really began in Chicago. And Torrio became one of the richest bootleggers. Al Capone became the richest one ever. And I guess a few policemen didn't do so badly either.
Yeah, we're doing the same thing, Grandpa. Expressing our discontent with society through our music. Give me the fuse.
No.
Why?
Because there's a difference between what you're doing and what the blues were doing in 1920.
What?
Well, for one thing, they didn't have synthesizers, electric guitars, microphones, and amps.
So?
So you didn't need a fuse to play the blues. Let's go.
Grandpa, come on, Grandpa.
We'll have peace at last.
Why what?
Why so big?
Oh, Myrtle.
Myrtle?
Yeah, that's her name. She had a 24-inch suspension lift. The rubber is 66 to 43. She's got a 5-ton military axle.
Named after my wife, God bless her.
Why do you need such big wheels?
Truth be told, ever since I was a teenager, I wanted to drive the hottest car in town. That was my teenage dream. Wasn't it yours?
You're right, it was. Yeah, 1916 was the year. I was living with my father in Princeton. It was spring, and I was going to take Nancy Stratemeyer to the junior prom in her father's Bugatti. In those days, regular high school kids simply didn't have cars. They only dreamed about them. Edison never did perfect that doctrine. I fulfilled my teenage dream. That day, I had the hottest car in town.
Well, that's just about the tallest car tale I ever heard.
And that's just about the tallest car I've ever seen.
Want to go for a spin in it?
The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles will be right back.